stand the rain against my window. Oh, oh, oh. Bringing back sweet memories. I can't stand the rain against my window.
Hey guys, welcome back to another exciting episode of Is It Wrong? A show that
Is It Wrong?
Is It Wrong, baby? A show that promises to bring you some exciting stories, inside stuff you probably won't hear anywhere else, and just to have a good time. My guest today is Brian Duncan. This guy's been four times Dove Award winner. You've been nominated, I don't know, several times. The vocalist of the year.
Are you kidding me?
Multiple Grammy nominations. And no, yeah. I'm not kidding you. And I think you got like 18 solo records, right? 18 or 19 or something like that. That's incredible.
Yeah, I haven't counted lately, but I think it's more than that. Now it's like 22 or something. Oh, they don't count the independent ones on Google, I don't think. And, you know, eventually, you know, the record company drops you because you're not interesting anymore. And, you know, they go for the younger people. And then you wind up doing independent stuff. So, I mean, I've done like six albums since the last record company.
Yeah, I'm going to play you something real quick I've been listening to a lot today. I love this song. Sound familiar?
I can't hear it. No, I still can't hear it.
Can you hear me now?
That's all right. I'm going to play it. I'm going to play it during the show, but anyways, Brian, man, it's such an honor to be here with you today, buddy. I remember as a kid, I'm sorry, you were going to say?
No, I'm just going, it's nice to be here. I haven't left my house, but so yeah, it's nice to be anywhere at this point.
Oh yeah, I'm sure. I remember as a kid, I saw you play at Wheaton College and Phil Keaggy was with you. I don't remember if he was actually playing with you or he was the opener.
Yeah, I mean, if Phil was there, he was playing. Now you got to be kidding me. It was like, I remember that gig in Wheaton with Phil Keaggy.
Yeah.
Because I mean, he got an encore that night and, you know, people were standing up and I finally went backstage because he wasn't coming out. And
yeah.
And it had been a long day. And I came back and backstage and I found him. He had fallen asleep in his suitcase.
Oh,
I'm going, hey,
God.
Do you want to do another song or you want me to just go tell people to go home?
Oh, man, I remember that. Gosh, it was so exciting because I'd been listening to you on the radio and then there you guys were. And then there's Phil Keaggy. I'm like, my goodness, man, it was great. It's a great show. You remember a lot of the shows from back in those days, don't you?
Actually, no. But, you know, what I remember most of the time is the disasters. You know, I mean, it's all the set was the same. Most of the time you were doing the same 10 songs everywhere. And so, you know, that part wasn't, it was just whatever blew up. That would be an interesting show. It's like, oh, I remember that gig. You know, remember when we drove the, remember when we high centered the bus trying to drive into a amphitheater and then the bus is hanging out in the middle in midair. Yeah, we remember those kind of things.
Yeah, that's great, man. Hey, so you grew up a preacher's kid. I know that. And when you, as you were growing up in the church with your dad, I heard you tell somebody that you basically were saved at birth or prior to birth or whatever. So you had this musical thing in you. Let's talk a little bit about your musical journey into the Sweet Comfort Band. Growing up, you know, were you automatically just into that kind of music or what? I know you grew up in Greg Laurie's church, right? You were part of the big Jesus movement and all that. And I know back then it was all hippie music or whatever. What was that big transition for you to go from that to like Sweet Comfort Band?
Well, actually Sweet Comfort Band was a transition from what I was doing at home. You know, I was in a group called the New Sounds of Creation down in Florida. I played guitar and I would sing my own song there when I was my first year of college. And that was like an up with people thing. You know, for me, you remember those? And you know, you wore a coat and tie and the girls looked like they were going to the prom. I only played in that one year because I kind of got booted out of Bible college that year. And it was mostly playing my own music. I was playing in I had my own group that we were playing around the colleges and the parks. So I was missing curfew quite a bit. You know, I get in at 1 o'clock, 2 o'clock in the morning. Back then, the Bible college had a curfew. You know, I don't know if they do that anymore, but you know, it was kind of like vacation Bible school.
Oh yeah, I remember that. I remember that. Yep. Yeah. So you got kicked out of Bible college. I think I heard you once say it because they didn't think you were preaching material or pastor material or something like that.
Yeah. The deans thought I wasn't really, you know, missionary material. He just says, you know, I don't really think this is your calling. And so I took him at his word. And I kind of went home, and that's when I saw. I had some of my relatives live out in California, and one of my cousins called, and she says, "You should come out here, man. Music is happening." And she sent me a tape of a group called Love Song.
Oh yeah.
And all I saw was Tommy Coombs, you know, with a guitar on the back of his, mm-hmm. you know, thrown over his back, you know, and he had that curly hair, and I'm going,
oh yeah,
I'm there, man. That looks like my crowd right there.
Yeah.
So, man. You know, I went out there, and ironically, I got to the Jesus music, you know, the tent, as they called it.
Yeah.
And, you know, I looked like an East Coaster. I was like, man, I'm still wearing a sports shirt and slacks. So, you know, I had to kind of, you know, get used to the new scene, as it were.
Yeah. Yeah. Did it take you a while to get used to it, or just kind of like walked into it?
I don't know. You know, I was kind of a fly on the wall most of the time. You know, I wasn't like the outspoken Jesus music hippie guy. You know, it wasn't, you know, that wasn't my conversion. I grew up in church. And
right.
I just wanted to do music that I knew how to play, and that meant me. That meant mine. I could write my own songs.
Mm-hmm.
I just couldn't play other people's very well.
And that's so, why you know, that's doing your own stuff.
Yeah, it wasn't really a lot of assimilation, I guess, but you know, the Jesus movement kind of happened around me. I went out there and hung around the outskirts of it, really. And so, I mean, Sweet Comfort Band, you know, Kevin and Rick, I met them at the tent. They came up to me after a Monday night. I had opened for Love Song. And I just played a couple songs there. I was like a new guy. And
yeah.
Kevin and Rick came up, and Kevin was a bass player. And he says, my brother plays drums. We was wondering if we could back you up next time. And that's it sounded great. Better than me playing by myself. So that was kind of the beginning of the Sweet Comfort Band. It was a three-piece group for almost a year and a half before we added Randy.
Wow. How'd you come up with the name Sweet Comfort Band?
Oh, I didn't. It was like, originally it was Sweet Comfort. The drummer said, I think we should call the band Sweet Comfort. And I thought it was awful. I'm going, sweet. Okay, whatever. You know, I wasn't really about the name or the image or any of that. So I was just about the music and the songs. And eventually we had to put band on the end of it because, you know, when we would call out to places saying, you know, I'm with Sweet Comfort, you know, mm-hmm. they always thought you were saying Sleep Comfort. And, you know, then you were just a mattress company, you know, yeah. No wonder we weren't getting gigs.
Oh man, that's great. That's great. And now, so just let's talk a little bit about the writing. Who did most of the writing for Sweet Comfort Band? Was that like a collective thing you guys all did, or somebody?
Well, you know, the first 3 years I was writing. I mean, the first year and a half we were writing. They were just playing my songs, and then I started writing some songs with Rick. But Rick was kind of a long-haired hippie freaky kind of guy. And he liked Sweet Comfort because it was another name for Jesus. And
oh wow, I didn't know that.
But then he liked vocal groups. That's why I was down there to hear Love Song, because they sounded like, you know, the Eagles and you know, whoever the vocal groups were. He really liked Orleans. Remember them? Together since way back. He really loved that stuff. And I think it was mostly because, you know, that his voice kind of sounded like that. And had that kind of a Don Henley scratchiness to it.
Yeah. 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 You know, my pastor used to say, you've got to have it before you can have it. When did you realize you had it? When you could start writing some music and stuff? How old were you when you said, I think I got this. I can start writing some music.
You know, I never felt like that. Writing songs was a hobby, you know, and really? You know, when you're in high school, you know, you're just trying to keep from committing suicide. Like, you know, you're having trouble with girls and, you know, nobody likes you. And there's this monstrous peer pressure. And I'd come home and get my dad's guitar out and play, you know, mean songs, you know, I can't, you can't, I don't like you anymore. Like that kind of stuff. And so it was never a, wow, I really feel like I could do this. I won a teen talent contest that my dad asked me to be in. And because I was the only male vocalist in it, so naturally I won. So
nice.
But that was the first time I ever thought about playing in front of an audience, actually, because, you know, there was like 30 or 40 people there. It's a small wow. church.
Yeah, sure.
So, you know, that was not a lot of competition. But, you know, after that, I went to college and I was still singing and playing songs. And I ran into all kinds of musicians that wanted to play. So,
sure.
I was playing in a couple of bands in Florida.
Mm-hmm. I actually live in Florida. I'm originally from Chicago, but I've been in Florida 30 years or so. Yeah,
I liked it enough. You know, it was kind of a little sticky for me. You know, eventually I thought California would be a, you know, fun place to go. Yeah. I mean, I've never left. So, you know, here I am.
And how long have you been there now?
I came out here in 1972. So I don't know. Do the math. 100 years. I've been there for
180
years. Of course, you know what? If you're in a band and you're touring all the time, it doesn't really matter where you are, you know, where you live, because you're never home. So there's that.
Yeah, yeah. Now, you and I we're both good buddies with Ricky B. Ryan. You've done some writing with him. Did he do some bass for you, or did he actually do some shows with you, or just, yeah?
No, Ricky, you know, we started a band, you know, I came across him, you know, at a bad time in my, you know, I was losing my marriage and, you know, I couldn't figure out what to do with myself. And so I would talk to him at night, you know, kind of talk me off the ledge, because that's kind of where you wind up when you can't figure out what's wrong with this picture.
Yeah.
And, you know, he said, well, you should just come up to Washington State, and I've got some guys up here that play, and we know all your songs already, so you could just come up, pick the songs you want to do, and we'll play them. So I went up there and met some of the best musicians I'd ever heard. I mean, I could leave the stage and go down the street for coffee and leave them playing, and nobody would miss me. That's the kind of band you want right there.
Oh,
you
know,
I'm going to. Well, that's going to be great, and I'm going on break.
Yeah. Yeah, Ricky, he's an incredible musician, and he plays so much. You know, he's really into the jazz thing and everything, and I think he's a great guy.
Well, he wasn't when I met him. He was, you know, he wanted to be a metal guy, you know, rock. And we had a lot of arguments about that because we started the Neo Soul band, and we did 2 records, I think. Can't remember now.
Yeah, he did mention that, yeah.
But the Neo Soul band was, it was more funk soul stuff.
Yeah. You know, yeah. I heard some of it. Yeah. Funky, jazzy, bluesy. Yeah.
We used to have knockdown, drag out arguments about playing ballads. Because in Christian music, you know, ballads are still the deal, you know. And so I knew I had to play at least 1 or 2 ballads during the set. And he just absolutely hated that. You know, it was like, sure. Oh man, we got to mellow out. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. But you know ballads.
What's that?
Ballads make a lot of bands. You know what I'm saying?
Most of the one hit wonders have been, you know, balladeers.
Yeah.
Yeah. Who was that group that had that really nice harmony thing. It's the only thing I ever heard them do. I'm thinking of it was, but it, when I looked them up, they were a metal band, and they had this one song, and I can't think of it to save my name because I'm 70 years old, and you know, I
was
having trouble dropping name.
Was it Silent Lucidity by Queensryche? Maybe.
Nope. It was, seemed like the band was X something. It wasn't In Excess. It was X something. But they had this song that was really, man, I'd have to look it up. It was just a really nice harmony. It was a duet with two of the guys in the band, and it was just, man, I can't think of it. Anyway, yeah, they were. This is the only song I heard of theirs. And see, now I still don't know them.
Yeah, well, hey, they must have had some one heck of an impact on your life, right?
Well, not really, but you know, it was one of the few songs, you know, that I liked on regular radio.
Yeah,
they're starting to become fewer and farther between all the time. So.
Yeah, music has evolved so much from what I believe to be good old rock and roll into all this new stuff. And I don't dog it. You know, we're a metal band, Sacred Warrior. And I'm the lead vocalist as well. I'm a singer, so I'm right there with you, but the spectrum is so broad now. And, that seems that the listener has become, more, what's the word I'm looking for? They just want to hear so much more different stuff. You know, it's not, they don't want to settle just for one thing. They want to go all the way from here to here and everything in between, you know?
Really? It all sounds the same to me. I'm going, you know, as soon as we invented, you know, cut and paste and computerized stuff, you know, it's just too easy to, you know, make things happen. I got a keyboard that can play a whole band thing, you know. It'll follow my left hand and, you know, oh, you want a country sound? And you play three notes on the left hand and it fills in the whole band for you. Drums, bass. Oh, yeah. And that's probably why, you know, the younger artists are trying to do something with just their voice, because, you know, everything's been copied and done. And, oh, you want that sound? Here it is. Bink. And
yeah.
So I don't know. It's, I mean, we're filling in the old people, role in the world today of, today's music ain't got the same soul.
Today's music ain't got the same soul. I like that old time rock and roll.
You knew that was coming, and you know somebody has to do that. We have to have a curmudgeon somewhere.
Yeah. No, it's funny. It's made it. Technology has made it so easy for people to become artists. You know, like you said, a keyboard, you got the whole band there. Back in the day, you know, you go into a studio, you got a budget, you got your drummer, you got your guitar player, everybody's laying down their tracks, and then you mix everything. Now you sit at a computer, write the whole song, mix it there, master it, lay down your vocal tracks, and you're done. You know, with that much budget, zero, you don't even need a budget. If you got a decent computer and you can record, you got it, man.
Well, I've heard some really good sounds that were just completely the engineer. I mean, it was all ear candy, and I'm going, wow, it sounds good. But now, you know, they got to invent a band to go out and pretend to play it or try to play it. We started using loops. The band didn't want to play that stuff because, you know, who wants to, you know, follow a click track? And so, I mean, that was kind of like, started to become worse as time went on. It didn't feel the same, and you never could get the sound to sound like the band when you got on stage because it was all synthetic.
Yeah. You know what's funny about click tracks? I'll tell you a little funny story about my band. So we're split up around the country. I'm in Florida. My one guitar player is in Oklahoma, and the rest of the band's in Illinois. And we rehearse I rehearse to my camera and he rehearses to his camera. I can control the soundboard with the sounds I want from the guys in Chicago and do my own mix, and he can do the same. And we have to really literally rehearse to a click track so we can all stay in the same tempo. But when we played live, our drummer Tony is so used to that click track, he's in the pocket now. But
yeah,
we're gonna try doing a show with the click track, and my guitar player Bruce, he's like, "Nah, we can't do that, man. What if the click track doesn't work or this or that?" So it's kind of difficult, right? So we didn't use it live. We don't use a click track live. However, a lot of bands do. But I will say, for rehearsal, that's great because it really helps to keep everybody in the pocket. You know what I mean?
Yeah, I just, you know, I just did a show on YouTube with some of the guys that I used to play with, Greg and Matt Bissonette. They're like studio rock stars. They played on everybody's records. And we did a show called Song in a Day. And they invited a lot of people from around the country to play on the song once we figured out what it was going to be. And it worked for them because, you know, those guys, are maybe they're set up so that they could just play it and send the files to you. But I am not a tech-savvy person. I couldn't even get my desktop to work for this. That's why I'm holding this phone, ladies and gentlemen, because, you know, I probably look really nervous. Or I'm making you dizzy by moving the phone around, but that's the only way I can get this to work. So,
yeah, is it wrong that Brian Duncan's doing his podcast on his phone? Not at all.
Well, that's a good thing because, you know, I'm an idiot when it comes to tech stuff. I have to have somebody in the room supervising me because I've deleted whole applications, you know, clicking on the wrong thing. Man. I stopped doing stuff at my house like that because we started sending MIDI files, you know, where it's just a series of dots and dashes across there, and then you send it to somebody, and then they can plug in any keyboard and it'll play that. This is no longer music in my book. I mean, you know, I've reached an age where, you know, I've got a few years left, but, you know, I'm going to go do something else.
Oh, you got plenty of time left. How old are you? 72?
71.
71. You know Les Carlson by any chance?
Oh, yeah. He lives across the valley.
Okay. Yeah. He's a great, great friend of mine. And I think he just turned 73. And that guy's so full of life, man. He's touring all over. He just got cast in a movie. I don't know if I did not just say that. Scratch at it. He did. Got cast in the movie, but I can't say what it is yet. But that guy, he's so full of life, man, you know? And you know, you just said you only got a few years left. You got a long time left, man. If you keep going and doing this.
You know, I think a lot of the energy when you're an old person is because as a musician, there's no benefits package. You're not going to retire. Yeah, so,
right.
Unless you're, you know, have a monster draw. So,
right.
But I started doing a podcast too. That's been blowing up. It's like, it's getting 5-star reviews on podcast apps, just because it's sarcastic. It's like,
oh, is it? Really?
I do a podcast called Nutshell Sermons, and it's mostly 2-minute sarcastic devotions. It's for people who've been around church for their whole lives, and you know they're already kind of nodding off because they've heard the preacher say this thing the same way for like 15 years, and now they could like correct him. Excuse me, you left something out.
Because they know the sermon.
Shall be ashamed of me and of my words in this adulterous and sinful generation.
Yeah, so the Nutshell Sermon's like that, and then I post something on Mondays called Prayers You Won't Hear in Church, you know, because those are funny. Dear God, I don't like some of your friends. That's one of them. And then I do a set of songs called Songs That Didn't Make the Last Record, because, you know, after COVID hit, man, we couldn't raise money to do a record. So, I decided, you know what, I'm not going to keep promising records. You know, if it can't be done, it can't be done. So,
right. That is really cool. That is really cool. I'm going to have to look that up, man. And they're just a bunch of little short videos.
Yeah. The video they're not even videos. It's audios.
Oh,
The devotional is 2 minutes long. And then I tell stories of Jesus and music where I tell my whole story on, from back. I go clear back to 1969, and each episode is about 8 minutes long, 7 to 8 minutes.
Wow.
And that's I just fantastic. Talk about every record I ever did. So I think I've covered 22 albums now, and I'm at the year 2000 wow. with Joyride is on there right now. So you can hear all the stories about why songs came about, and some of them are just funny because nobody quite understands. You know, you get this spiritual song. I had this song on Joyride called Clap Your Hands. Clap your hands, you know, Jesus. And everybody, that was a big popular song. And somebody asked me why I was, you know, how I came to write that, you know, and I says,
yeah,
I was in a hotel room and the clapper, the clapper commercial came on. Clap on, clap off, the clapper.
Clap on, clap off, clap on, clap off, the clapper.
Let you turn things on or off from anywhere in the room.
And that thing was huge. And we find yourself singing it all the time. And so it's like, you know, how come no preacher ever jumped on that? You know, finally, we just clap our hands and the lights come on. You know, it seemed like a great sermon. So, you know, that's what the stories of my records are. It's like where I was and what I was doing when I wrote that. And they're usually, they might be disparaging if you thought I was walking on clouds the whole time. Because, you know, that never happened.
Yeah, that's great, man. You know, we all get inspiration from somewhere for writing, right? And it's funny that the clapper was such an inspirational thing for you there.
You know, I've been irritated by commercials too, and written songs, you know, just to argue with them. So
yeah,
and I can't think of one right now, but probably a better thing. But you know, all the songs, you know, I remember this guy telling me a story about, I wrote a song called Everything in the Garden.
I was the first man in Eden, back in the garden, had a great little place. It was just me and the Lord, and we never got bored. We invented the whole human race. Then we went for a walk in the evening. He said, I can't help.
And it's the story of Adam. From Adam's point of view, it's like, and it all started because this guy said, he's telling me about a taco stand, and he says, you know, you should try these tacos, man. They're outrageous. He said, but he called it a sweet little find, and I thought, that's a great coin phrase. That'd make a great line in a song. It's a sweet little find. But then I went there and I ate, and the tacos were horrible. I just hated them. And I'm going, it was a sweet little find that I should have declined. And, you know, and then it became a story of Adam talking about Eve handing him, you know, that piece of bad fruit. And then he's trying to explain to himself, you know, it was the woman. I had nothing to do with it. So, you know, that song went over, you know, nominal, because you got to bring it just a touch of sarcasm if you're going to enjoy the songs.
Oh, yeah, yeah. And not only in your music, pretty much in your life and everything you do, right?
Sarcasm, you think?
Yeah, to keep
people well, especially nutshell sermons. Nutshell sermons are, you know, they're always, you know, something obnoxious. I usually start them with something that's irritating, you know. You ever tried to paint your house and not get any paint on you? I don't need no stinking drop cloth. And then you go off on you know, how that went. You know, paint all over. Next thing you know, you're painting the dining room table.
That's great. That's great. Hey, before we started the podcast, I happened to see that guitar up on the wall. You want to talk a little bit about that? That guitar behind you on the wall?
I can't see it very well. I'm just trying to keep my face in the picture.
That's all right.
Yeah, right there.
Yeah.
That's my dad's guitar, and that's him up above smiling. He got Alzheimer's at the end, about the last 7 years, so he kind of didn't know anybody except me. He knew who I was, and he knew where the Oreo cookies were in the kitchen.
Of course.
But you know what's really interesting too is that he couldn't remember people, couldn't remember his name, he couldn't remember. Eventually he died because he couldn't remember how to swallow, and he had a DNR, but he could remember songs, man. I've got a clip of him someplace, of him playing a Wholesome Bread commercial from like 1945. It's like da 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 da. It was like he was singing it like Roy Rogers would sing it.
Yeah.
And, so I mean, it was kind of, he was entertaining even when he didn't know who he was.
Yeah, yeah. So he was a musician then, obviously.
Well, yeah, he played guitar. My mom played piano, and well, they both played piano. But that's a Martin hollow body electric, and there was only 1,400 of them made. And I don't think he knew that he had that. You know, when he got it, he just replaced. He had a Gibson hollow body Coronado One. And somebody stole it out of the church. So he bought that thing, and it was just like, oh, that looks nice. I think he bought it because it was wood grain. You know, yeah, see there, it's kind of a wood grain.
Beautiful. Yeah, yeah, it's beautiful, yeah. Man.
I haven't played it for, you know, since he died. So, but I have a little shrine in my back, in the backyard.
Do you?
Yeah, he didn't write songs or nothing. I just wrote songs because I couldn't play as good as he could. So
yeah, yeah. Did you and him have a great relationship?
Most of the time, you know, we didn't argue too much.
Yeah,
but you know, I got all my humor from him. He was such a sarcastic, you know, guy. For a preacher, you know, he loved jokes and he loved words. He loved the bigger the word, the more fun he would have with it. Of course, that's probably every preacher, right? He would come in. I remember he wrote a note because I was busted in seventh grade for talking in class, and I had to go get a note from my dad and bring a note back that he had seen that I was in trouble for talking. And so he writes a note to the teacher, and she put it on the bulletin board of the teacher's lounge because he just says, "Yes, I'm Reverend Daniel R. Duncan. I understand that my son was reprimanded this week, and I completely understand that a general cessation in superfluous vocables is considered necessary for an atmosphere conducive to satisfactory learning conditions."
Oh my gosh!
Signed, Reverend Duncan.
Oh my gosh!
She thought that was so funny that, you know, she probably had to look up half those words.
Oh, sure. Yeah.
That was my English teacher, too, by the way. Figured.
Hey, and all of a sudden you weren't in trouble anymore, right?
She wasn't any nicer to me than after that. Oh. But I, you know, I won a storybook award in the seventh grade. You know, I won a book of lifesavers. it was a big award for it was my first writing award. It was a Christmas story about Santa in modern day, where he pulls up in a 65 Ford, you know, he's eating a bowl full of jelly or something. So I was like,
"That's great."
So I was doing the smart aleck thing before I even started writing songs.
Wow, man. Collectively, how many songs would you say you've written over the years?
Well, I don't know, but I know that Spotify has 140 of them and they don't pay diddly, you know, I even called him once and I said, "Look, you got 140 of my songs. I should get Spotify for a discount. I mean, I should get a subscription for free for my car."
Yeah. And what they
said. They wouldn't even do that. So I don't subscribe to Spotify and I don't listen to them in my car.
Yeah.
I know iTunes has 140 songs too, but I know there's a lot of songs that didn't make the record. I've got 25 or 30 on the Nutshell Sermons that are, some of them are done and some of them are half done.
Mm-hmm.
And some of them are ideas and some of them were mistakes. And it was a good thing they didn't make a record.
Yeah. I think we all of us artists have several of those, right?
Oh, well, man. You know, I believe I'm a believer in redemption, you know, man, we're going to make this dog. We're going to make this dog scream. You know, just get out of the way. All we need is another drummer.
Yeah.
We'll bring in somebody else and we'll fix it in the shrink wrap.
There you go. Oh, boy. Yeah. 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 Hey, so nowadays, besides the podcast that you do, are you doing any more touring or any more writing now? Or are you just kind of just doing shows?
Oh, yeah. In fact, I'm writing a bunch of songs with Bob Carlisle. You remember him?
Oh, yeah, of course.
You know, he's done
Kisses with a Mom.
Yeah.
There.
Oh, yeah, yeah, that he's not a big fan of that. He's like, okay, because you know, I mean, he grew up in Latin funk world, and he's writing songs for a couple of different people because of his notoriety.
Right.
So I mean, he's been calling me up every late night and asking me to write lyrics to stuff that he's making up on the fly.
Really?
Yeah, we're writing. Well, he did a whole record recently that we wrote all the songs together except one, called Lil Bobby C and Big Motor. You can find that on Amazon.
Side of the jail cell in Mississippi, I met a free man from Memphis, Tennessee. The freedom's road's looking mighty slippery. Still doing hard time. Devil's in his mind. He's got a screw loose and need asylum.
But it's more the Latin funk soul thing that that he liked. And the whole record is about going back to Santa Ana where he grew up and, you know, playing with his friends, playing music with his friends. And then we're writing songs for this chick singer. She sounds kind of like Janis Joplin.
Wow.
So it's kind of a new thing to write from a woman's perspective for me. He doesn't seem to have a problem with it, but, you know, I'm going, man, I can't write for a woman's perspective. I don't even understand my wife is at this point.
How long have you been married?
We just had our anniversary, you know, about 20 years, 20-something.
That's great.
Oh, and don't tell her that I don't know the exact number.
Oh, I won't. Hey, my lips are sealed. I know nothing.
All right.
Wow. Wow, man. Hey, let's talk about Bob Carlisle for a second. Is he doing anything now other than writing? Do you know?
He doesn't really need to do anything, you know. Butterfly Kisses, you know, I remember we were in a Motel 6 somewhere when he got that first check.
Yeah.
For just 1 week of airplay on Butterfly Kisses. It was a number one song in three different genres. And I think the first check was just a couple of dollars short of $1 million. And that was just for the week.
Wow.
So, yeah, that probably ruins your motivation for, you know, doing anything. And yeah, I think he's just writing now. He's just writing now for the fun of it. You know, he wow. likes doing it. And I like writing with him because, you know, he's such a smart aleck. And he'll call me up and he'll send me a piece of music. And he says, I just got one word. Chains. Like, so he made me come up with lyrics for a one word song, and we did that on my record and on his new one. It goes, chains come in every shape and size, chains don't hardly feel them after a while.
Oh my gosh.
It worked pretty well, actually.
Yeah, I bet.
So it's almost like a practice, like that psychology thing. They give you a word and you know, you come up with what it makes you think of.
Right, right. That is so cool. That is so cool. What's in the near future for you as far as end game? You just plan on just keep doing what you're doing now, or you really considering doing another record sometime, or are you just kind of happy with the podcast and...
It's hard to tell, you know. I haven't been trying to force my own will on God, you know. I haven't thrown Jesus out with the bathwater. I don't like some of his friends, but you know, I'm just here for him till he tells me to come home. And
yeah,
you know,
man,
I can't believe he's kept me here. That's what I can't believe is, like, wow, I never planned on being this old.
Yeah,
thought he would come back for everybody by now, but. So far, nothing. And so I'm just going to do the next right thing, whatever happens this week. Mm-hmm. I didn't see the Song in a Day show. It was released last week on YouTube. Look up Song in a Day. Okay. And it's like being a fly on the wall in the studio with some of the best musicians you've ever heard. The Bissonettes played. They played on my records most of the time. And did I lose you? No.
No, no.
I ain't touch screens, man. You just barely brush the screen and it, you know, sends you to hell.
Yeah, yeah.
All right. So anyway, that's what I was talking about. I'm really gung-ho about the nutshell sermons. They're fun. They're easy to write and they're hysterical because I have a gnat's eyebrow of an attention span. So, you know, if I wait 3 seconds, the whole story is going to change.
Oh yeah. Yeah. I know that. Wait, who is this? What's your name? No.
Yeah. Yes. I know that one.
Yeah. No, it's great, man. Well, listen, Brian, man, I'm so glad we got to share this time together, buddy. I learned a lot about you, and I hope, you know, you had a good time here. And
This was fun. I mean, I can always hang backstage with, you know, with the rock stars. You know, you guys are still playing, right?
Yeah, yeah, we are. Yep. Yeah, I'll
play once in a while, but yeah. I just don't play a lot. And I got grandkids. I enjoy being home.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah. Just last Saturday, we had a show in Germany. We did. Then we got some.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, that was great. We played for this festival called Keep It Loud or Keep It True or something like that.
Yeah.
Sold out, and it was just the people in Germany, they are so into their metal,
you know,
music.
all over Europe, man, metal stuff is still going. It's still going good. I was in Sweden last summer for one gig, but it wasn't, you know, but that I did notice that there was, you know, a lot of metal bands in the airport.
Yeah, oh yeah, yeah. Yeah, no, them Europeans still love their metal, man. For sure.
Them are Europeans, boy. They sure like their metal stuff.
Yeah, yes, I do. Yes, I do.
That's my southern southern slang.
Yeah, and they all wear all the goth stuff and the chains and you know, I'm all tatted up. I don't know if you saw that, but that's all part of, you know, had that for you.
Oh yeah,
you know?
Yeah. No, I understand. You know, I just didn't go into the metal thing because I couldn't decide on a tattoo and I didn't fit into those tight leotards. So I just kind of stayed with funk soul. I like soul and blues, and now I couldn't get a tattoo if I wanted to. You know, I'm at an age where if I bump into the wall, I'll start to bleed. This is wow, you look down and you're going, how did that happen? I'm bleeding profusely. So
yeah, I rolled weird in bed. That's how that happened.
Yeah, that's kind of the way it happens.
Yeah, yeah. I'm feeling you, man. I'm 62, and it's weird. You get a little injury, and it seems like it lasts forever, man. When you were a kid and younger, you get cut, you get up, you're back in the dirt again. Now you get a little cut, and you're like, hey, I got to stay clean. I can't, you know, and it seems like it takes forever to heal.
And you know, I watch TV now, and I'm watching, you know, chase scenes where the guy's running through the alley, and then he jumps on this and flips over a car, and I'm going, man, I can't do any of that stuff anymore. It's like, you know, I used to. I'm going, that's when you notice. You start noticing stuff that people are doing on TV that you couldn't do if your life depended on it.
Oh,
so.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, no doubt.
Well, it gets worse. Trust me. It's like, wait till you get 70. It's like, wow. And then when you get injured, you kind of wonder if you're going to ever recover. Is this it? Am I just never going to come back? Because, you know, you hear people. You hear about people, you know, falling and breaking their hip, and then it's all downhill from there. And I'm going, man, I hope that's not the case.
Yeah. Brian, I got a little cut that big on my shin, I don't know, a month ago. And it's just now healing up. The skin's finally where it's healing up. I'm like, what the heck, man? You know, you just don't know, man.
You might need a witch doctor, you know, somebody. I got a couple of friends that bring you over aloe vera and make you take, you know, vitamin E and, you know, we'll fix you up.
Yeah. Yeah. Man. Well, listen, we're going to finish up here. Hang in there for a second. All right. We'll talk some more. All right.
All right.
All right. And guys, thanks for watching this. Listen, remember to share and like this. We spent some great time with Brian Duncan, really getting to know him. Watch his podcast, watch his short stories. I'll post links to everything when I edit this. And remember to please share. Until then, God bless. Is it wrong?